Next talk is given by Mike Franz Vignahas from Paris. So his title is not the same as in the online. So anyway, we will see that.
It is almost the same.
Yeah. So, you can start. Please.
So the title is smooth has been replaced by admissible and over, and I added commutative for ring. Okay. So what was the title? What was the original title?
So the title is the representations of reductive periodic groups.
Okay, so it's a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
So let us start. So I will fix local non-Archimedean field of characteristic P finite residue field. So this means that it is either a finite extension of QP, in this case the characteristic is zero, or a finite extension of FP of T, in this case the characteristic is P. So I fix the connected F group. Anyone, no restriction, it can be split or not semi-simple, so any connective reductive F group. But I suppose that the semi-simple rank is positive, otherwise all what I say is empty. So the locally profinite group G, which is a point of the F point, contain an open propice subgroup, and I will also call it a connected reductive group. And R is a cumulative ring. It will be a ring of coefficients. So we are looking at the category of smooth representation of G over R. This category is very good category, is abelian and even Grothendieck. I recall for some of you, maybe, so, you know, that smooth means that the every vector in the R module is fixed by an open subgroup of G. And admissible means that for any compact open subgroup of G, the R module of a fixed vector is finitely generated. I don't define the category of admissible representation because it's not a very good category. If it is not abelian in UG, usually. And so I don't define it. So the way to construct, so we want to construct admissible representation. So we start to try to construct smooth representation. And the classical way is to start from a group that is of, which is smaller than G. And the way one does it is using parabolic induction. So you start with a parabolic subgroup P of G, different from G, of unipotent radical N, and Levy subgroup M. So it is isomorphic to the quotient of P by N. And it is a connective reductive subgroup of G. And you use smooth parabolic induction, starting from smooth representation of M, then you inflate it to, you identify it to a representation of P that is trivial on N, and then you induce. And this reflects this diagram of suggestion from P to M and the inclusion of P inside of G. So from sigma represents smooth representation of M. You associate representation of P, trivial of N. which inflates sigma, and then you induce representation from P to G. There is no normalization here, so it is a function of G with values in the space of sigma that are locally constant because you want the thing to be smooth at the end, and with a functional equation f of pg is equal to sigma tilde of p f of g, and g acts by right translation. So it is a smooth representation of g, constructed from a representation of m. So this functor is extremely important. It is exact and transitive. This is all what I'm going to use now, but maybe later, if I have time, I will also use the fact that it has a left adjoint and a right adjoint, which is a very important property. So there is a natural filtration on this induced representation. And the quotient of this integral of this filtration are the representation I am interested in over any commutative ring. So this filtration is obtained like that. You start by extending P, sigma tilde, with the sigma of what is happening. I don't see it. I don't know what happened. Ah. You extend sigma tilde as far as possible to a parabolic subgroup. So it is a representation of P, and you try to extend it to G. You don't always can. You cannot always do it, but you can at least extend it to maybe another one, another parabolic that is bigger. And there is a maximal one that I will denote by P of sigma. And the extension to P sigma, in fact, is unique. In some sense, you start doing some Clifford theory. When you start with something, you will try to extend it before inducing. As a part, it is very easy to describe the P sigma when you have sigma. For instance, you can extend sigma to G. If it is possible, then sigma should act. So the transaction, so all the conjugates of N by G intersection with M should act trivially on sigma because you started to inflate to P. But in fact, the reverse is true. If you have this property, then P sigma is equal to G. So the smooth representation we expect to which extend to G are just the smooth representations that are trivial on this subgroup. And now you use the transitivity to write the induction from P to G as induction from P to P sigma, and then the induction from P sigma to G. But this one, because sigma extends, C tilde extend to P sigma, is just a tensor product of the extension is sigma by the induction of the trivial representation of P to P sigma. And now you understand what I'm going to do. You know I want a natural filtration of N P to G of sigma, but I will deduce it from the natural well-known filtration from P to P sigma of the trivial representation given by the generalized Steinbeck representation. So the general Steinbeck representation that I denote by ST P sigma on the top because it's a representation of P sigma and indexed by Q, with Q is contained P sigma, but contain P, they are given by this exact sequence. You take the induction of the trivial representation here. It contains all the sum of all these representations you induce from Q prime, which is bigger than Q, but containing P sigma, But you don't want to have Q, of course, otherwise you have everything. It is, and then the question is this generalized Tanberg representation. So now you tensor this by a sigma, this filtration by a sigma, and you get a filtration of the induced representation of sigma using that the smooth parabolic induction is exact. It's okay? And then you are interested by the quotients that I write like that. These are the representations that are defined over any commutative ring. And they are quite important. And you see, they are associated to triple P sigma Q, sigma a smooth representation of M, which is a Levy of P, and Q contained in P sigma, the maximal parabolic subgroup where sigma extends, and Q contained P. That's this representation. So it's as usual, you like to fix a minimal parabolic subgroup B of G, and you fix a Levy subgroup Z, and it is well known that parabolic subgroups containing B are in bijection with a subset of the simple roots of G associated to B. And from now on, I will use that later. This is why I do that. And from now on, I will suppose that P contains B and Z is containing the Levy of P. Normalization. Okay. So what about this representation? So we're interested in admissible representation. So the question, if sigma is admissible, are these representations admissible? So you remember how I defined them? I started with the parabolic induction and P of G of sigma. So theorem, yes, if sigma is admissible, then the induction is admissible. Well, as my representation are sub-quotient of an admissible representation, you want to say, but now it's clear they are admissible. Well, this is not always true because we have a counterexample of an admissible representation with a subquotient that is not admissible. So we are not totally sure that it is true, that it will be admissible. The counterexample happens only when the characteristic of F is equal to zero. Oh. I'm sorry, I should have done something else. I wanted, before going to admissibility, I wanted to give example of this representation so that they are very clear in our head. So when P sigma is equal to G, you see there is no induction. It is just a tensor product, and this tensor product is denoted by ST of Q of sigma. And it is called extended generalized Sternberg R representations. Extended because you have this E of sigma. If there is no E of sigma, it's just what is called the generalized Sternberg representation. And when P is equal to B, so P sigma is G, and suppose P is equal to B, so this is this general Sternberg representation that are I, G of B, 1, and Q. When Q is equal to G, you have the trivial representation, STG, which corresponds to here B, 1, G. When Q is equal to G, what is happening when Q is equal to G? So you have only the extension E of sigma, which is STG of sigma. And here you can have P different from B. Another example, when P sigma is equal to P, then there is only one Q. This is a case where sigma cannot be extended at all to a parabolic bigger than P. And then what you get is only the induced representation, because Q is also equal to P sigma, and you get the induced representation only when sigma cannot be extended further. Okay, these are these representations. Now, admissibility. So, as I said, the induction respect admissibility. The extension also is clear, respect admissibility, it's absolutely clear. So, when R is noetherian, you can prove that the Sternberg representation, generalized Sternberg, is also admissible. This was proved by Grosse-Klonne and Lee. Grosse-Klonne supposed that F was characteristic zero and the group was split, and Lee did it in general. Noetherian is a very natural condition for admissibility because you want a sub-representation of a representation to be if the representation is admissible, the sub should be admissible, and for this you need noetherian, that R is noetherian. So when R is noetherian and P is invertible or nilpotent in R, then you can prove that the tensor product of the general Sternberg representation by E of sigma is admissible, if sigma is admissible. So the extended general Sternberg representation is admissible. And then because this one is induced by from this one, it is also admissible. This was proved by Abbé, Enyar, and myself last year. So this representation, AG, P, sigma G, appear when C is algebraically closed field of characteristic P, where we prove that this map, we associate that to a triple, this representation gives a bijection from the triple where sigma is reducible and admissible and super singular modulo isomorphism to the irreducible admissible C representation of G modulo isomorphism. So if you restrict to sigma irreducible, admissible and super singular, when C is a field of classic P, then you get all the reducible, admissible representation of G. So this is of course extremely important, shows that this representation are fundamental. And this was proved when C is weakly closed. It has a long history. So it started in 1994 by Bartel and Livné when GL2. Then there was a big, very important paper by Ersich in 2011, where he extended the case GL2 to GLN. It was a big step. And then Abbé, 2 years later, went from GLN to G-split. And then we joined the team, Enyar and myself, in 4 years later to do it for NAG. And 2 years later with ENIA, we show that exactly the same classification holds true when C is not algebraically closed, which was a surprise, because it's so simple. We should be aware that it's not a classification, although I call it classification theorem, because we don't know how to classify super singular representation. With one exception, it's GEL2QP, where it was done by Bartel, Livni, and Breuil, and a few related groups over QP. This is the classification of super singular representation is an open problem, very important problem. But maybe you don't know what is super singular. There are many different definitions, and they are, of course, equivalent. We have a definition with Olivier that we gave in 2 years ago, which uses the Proppy-Iwari-Heck algebra. So I introduce this Proppy-Iwari-Heck algebra. So we fix the Proppy-Iwari subgroup, which is compatible with B, and we consider this Heck algebra, which is over any commutative ring, in particular the ring of integers, where I don't put any index, h of g, of I in g, which is just the convolution algebra of the double coset space. And super singular, well, it is defined over a field of characteristic P, because when the field has a characteristic different from P, there are no super singulars. But for field of characteristic P, you have this super singular representation. So we say that we define it for a representation is irreducible and admissible. Irreducible and admissible. You see, it is super singular if it is invariant by I is super singular as the right module for the Proppy-Iwari-Heck algebra. Well, you just look at the Proppy-Iwari-Heck algebra, it can be seen on the vector invariant by I. And this vector invariant by I is never zero because the field of characteristic P and the Proppy-Iwari subgroup has pro order power of P, P to the infinity. And as for finite group, if you take a representation of G, then it always has a vector which is not zero, it always has a vector that is fixed by I, that is vector non-zero vector fixed by I. It's the same proof than for a finite group, P group. So I don't need it, but we have a similar definition for ordinary representation. Now we want to, what does it mean that the module for the Heck algebra is super singular? Here you see, I don't suppose the module to be simple, because when you look at the invariant vector of pi by I, it's not always simple because the characteristic is P. So the definition of supersingularity is given for any module for the Proppy-Iwari-Heck algebra, and it says that you want a certain central element of H of G, in fact, it is in the 1 over Z, là, acts locally nilpotently, which means that if you take an element in the module, there will be a power of this element which acts by zero. I can give the same definition for ordinary. The difference is that the action of that G is invertible. So I am sorry, I cannot give you the definition of this. It is to be too long. But well, it is kind of simple definition, but too long. So I said that there is a problem. We don't know how to classify this reticle supersingular function of G. But until recently, we even didn't know if there exists admissible, irreducible, supersingular representation of G. And we still do not know if the characteristic of F is P. But if the characteristic of F is zero, we can prove with Kosiol and Ersich that there is always an irreducible, admissible, supersingular representation. And why you have this restriction? Because our proof uses two properties that are false when the characteristic of F is equal to P. The first property is that the subquotient of an admissible C representation is admissible, true for characteristic F is equal to zero. And the second property is that G contains discrete co-compact subgroups. And this is also false for when characteristic of L is equal to P, false for all G. And when G contacts discrete co-compact subgroups, if R is Noetherian, in particular if R is equal to C, then we get for free, well, with the compact discrete subgroup, a family of admissible R representation of G that are given by the smooth representation, regular R representation of G mod gamma, which is R of the limit of all open compact subgroup of G of the R of this space. This is a small S. So all these family of admissible representations of G are defined over R, and appear everywhere, and their properties should be systematically studied. And in fact, it is using this representation that we can construct a lot of super singular representation, because we prove that so when R is equal to C, or classic P, any field of classic P, it admits a super singular irreducible subquotient. And with some extension for G, but the exception are all of semi-simple rank equal to one. And for this exception, you are very lucky because we have the Pascunas method of G coefficient on the tree, which gives an admissible representation with a super singular irreducible subquotient. And the Pascunas method is quite interesting because Pascunas method works without restriction on the characteristic of F. And happily, to be sure that this subquotient is admissible, you suppose that characteristic of L is equal to zero in order to use this property. And maybe it's not necessary, but we don't know how to do it otherwise. Okay, what time is it now? Okay. So I'll give you some words on how the classification theorem is proved. For C algebraically closed, so we started with GL2, then GLN, then G split, and then any G. At each step, some techniques do not work, and they are replaced by working out some property on the Propy-Warry-Haeckel algebra. really the proof for C-Agreement clause is really the essential ingredient is the property of the Propy-Wari-Hacke algebra, which did not appear when you were working with GL2, Barton and Livne, or even in Herzog when we are working with GLN, because he didn't need them, because GLN is special. It's easier than any group G. But I will not say more like this. Just really the property of Propy Wari-Hacke algebra are fundamental. When for C not algebraically closed, you deduce it from the algebraically closed case, and you add another theorem, which is also very general and deserved to be known, that we call with Enyar the decomposition theorem that I will give to you, because it works in many different situations, not only for groups, but also for algebras, different algebras. So the proof when C is not really closed is as follows. You start with a representation that is reducible and admissible. And you take the scalar extension to an algebraic closure of C. Scalar extension. And then you take an irreducible subquotient of this scalar extension. And you apply the classification theorem over algebraic closure. So the subquotient is isomorphic to one of representation associated to triple P sigma A Q with sigma A irreducible, admissible, and super singular. So, okay, but now you want to descend to G. And then the claim is that this representation over CA is sigma isotypic, meaning a direct sum of representation isomorphic to sigma as a representation over C for sigma irreducible, admissible, and supersingular with and the extension of the P sigma A is the same thing that P of sigma. I mean, you remember it's a parabolic subgroup where sigma A can extend, the biggest one, the maximum one. But it is the same thing for sigma A and for sigma. So this means that the Q here, which was contained in P of sigma A, is also contained in P of sigma. So you can define our representation. And it remains only to prove that this representation is irreducible by our theorem. And you have to prove that it is irreducible. And then to prove it is irreducible, you prove it's equal to pi. Okay, this is the idea of the proof. And what is the decomposition theorem? So this decomposition theorem is the following. You start with any field, any characteristic of algebraic closure CA and any smooth irreducible representation, but it is supposed not admissible, it's not necessary. It's enough to suppose that the dimension intertwiners is finite, intertwiners of pi. Dimension over C is finite. This is the finiteness condition, which is, it does not imply that pi is admissible, but if pi is admissible, then you have this finiteness condition. Then you look at the scalar extension of pi to C. Then you can describe it. So what I need here is only I don't need that at finite length, but it has finite length. And its irreducible subquotient, this is what you are interested in, are absolutely irreducible. and defined over a finite extension of C, the descent to a finite extension of C. And they are all conjugate by the C automorphism of C. In the other direction, if pi is admissible, then the irreducible subquotients are also admissible. And it's even equivalent. Why it's equivalent? Because in other directions, if you start with some representation that as I play close field here, CA, which is absolutely irreducible, and defined over a finite extension of C, then you can go down as a representation over C, pi A is isotypic, pi isotypic for pi irreducible, representation of G over C, smooth, with the finiteness condition that the intertwiner algebra has finite dimension. So this allows to go down from sigma A to sigma, and then you have to work out a little more to get all this. And of course, if pi A is admissible, pi is admissible. So sigma here will be admissible. So now I will go to Proppi, Iwari, Heck algebra and their module. In fact, all the classification theorem that I gave before, the classification theorem you can see here, remain exactly the same for Proppi, Iwari, Heck algebra. We have the similar theorem of classification that was proved by Abbe, and I will give it to you. So there is a mirror theory for module for Proppi, Iwari, Heck algebra. You can construct over any commutative ring module if you start from a triple just defined as before, but with this Heck algebra. So new will be module over R, I forgot the R here, which will extend to module for the Iwari Heck algebra over R of M of nu, where M of nu is a Lewy subgroup of P of nu that will contain M. Instance is not clear how to define it. It's very subtle because the Heck algebra of M does not embed in the Heck algebra of M of nu. But there is definition that I don't give to you because take too much time, but it can be done. And the module is just has the same form, using the same three steps, just extension. Then you twist by your Sternberg module, but the Sternberg module, the definition is easy. They are just you start with the Sternberg general Sternberg representation for two here, for the group, and you take the vector invariant by the Proppi Iwari subgroup, and you get here the Sternberg generalized module here. And then you induce. And parabolic induction. And what is the parabolic induction for Heck algebra? So it is a functor going from module over the HM to module over HG, which is coincide with the image in some sense via the proxy invariant factors of the parabolic induction for the group. It just corresponds to the parabolic induction for the group. So this corresponds parabolic induction for the group. This corresponds taking the proxy invariant vector. This corresponds to the Steinberg compensation for the group. And in some sense, this will also correspond, but it's more subtle. In fact, a thesis of last year of Claudius Heyer, I hope I pronounce it well, Claudius Heyer, a student of Grosse Clone, describes this parabolic induction in a very nice way, which reflects the suggestion from P to M and injection from P to G. He constructed homomorphism from the Heck algebra of P with respect to the intersection of I with P, which is the proxy or Heck algebra of P, morphism to H of M, and another morphism to H of G. And our parabolic induction is on exactly the tensor product by H of G over H of P, which is very nice. And I think it's a very nice way to describe it. And maybe all what we have written should be rewritten using, it can be rewritten like that. It would be simplified things. And so now our module can be written like that. You define the extended generalized Steinberg HRM module like that, this one, like this, and you tensor it by H of G over this parabolic Hecker algebra. As I say, there is a classification theorem for C algebraically closed field of characteristic P proved by Abbe in 2077 that we extended to C not algebraically closed with Enyar last year using the same trick, the same proof. And you get this theorem that recalls that C is a field classic P, then the map from the triple to this representation gives a bijection from the triple where nu is simple and super singular modulo isomorphism to the simple modulo isomorphism. From now on, for simplify, although it was not totally necessary, I will suppose that C is algebraically closed of characteristic P. So this theorem is a full classification theorem because super singular simple modules are known. Olivier classifies them in 2014 when the group is split, but their classification can be extended in general. And in fact, I extended it for more general algebras than the proxy or Heck algebra, mais to algebra, Heck algebras that are called generic, and they are attached to combinatorial data and parameters exactly as the proxy Iwari Heck algebra. And the proof of the classification works exactly the same. There was no reason to consider only this Heck algebra. And I was quite happy when Abbe, in his last paper on a simple module for the proxy Iwari Heck algebra, he has his last paper is is a reduction of extension between the simple Hashi module to extension between super singular simple modules of generic Hacker algebra. You cannot restrict to Propy or Hacker algebra. You need to use generic Hacker algebra. If you want to work extension between simple Hashi module. And this paper is not published, and it will be published, of course. And it's a very, very important paper, I think, because when G is equal to GL2, this was done by Breuil and Pascunas, and they use it for GL2 to work out extension between simple representation of G instead of the Propy theory. So the extension theorem of Abbe is the following. So he supposed C as really close of classic B, and U1 and U2 simple super singular, because he wanted to look at only simple symmetry. And then he look at extension for every I of simple module associated to triple in the category of H C of G module. Then it is equal to zero if P1 different from P2. Fine. And then you suppose P1 is equal to P2 is equal to P. And then he proved it is isomorphic to extension I minus some integer, an integer which depends of Q1 and Q2 only, which is a symmetric difference between the set of simple modules, of simple roots associated to Q1, delta Q1. I told you that Q1 and Q2 will contain B, and then Q1 is parameterized by the subset, by the set of simple roots, delta Q1, and Q2 parameterized by the set of simple roots, delta Q2, and you take delta is the symmetric difference between delta Q1 and delta Q2, which is you look at the union, minus intersection, and you will take the number of elements of this asymmetric difference. So this is this thing. If Q1 is equal to Q2, so there is nothing. And then here, it is not the Propy Wari Hacker algebra of M, but a quotient of the Propy Wari Hacker algebra of M by an ideal, which acts by zero of U1 and U2. So U1 and U2 are simple module for this algebra over C. And they are also super singular, in fact, for this algebra, because this algebra, in fact, is a generic Hacker algebra. It's not a Propy Iwari Hacker algebra attached to a connective recursive group, but it is a generic Hacker algebra. And these are modules, super singular modules for this Hacker algebra. Look how beautiful and simple it is, I mean, this extension. So, but you have to be able to construct ext for a simple super singular module of generic Hacker algebra, C algebra. So Abbe calculated all the x1 for any generic, all this module, all the x1, and this gives x1 between any two simple modules for G, because if delta, you can see that because, let me see. You want to compute X1. So you have S1, 1 minus delta. So if delta bigger than 2 or equal to 2, it will be 0. So you look at delta is equal to 1, then it X0, that but X0 is an ohm, then because it will be it's an ohm, so it will be an ohm between U1 and U2, so it will be 0 of 1 because they are simple and super simple. They are simple. Then if delta is equal to 0, that will be X1. So if you know what are the X1 between U1 and U2, then you know what is the X1 between two simple modules for the for H of G. This computation of X1 was done by Broy and Pascunas in 2012 for PGL2F. Because you are fixing the central character. Here, you have X1 for in a G, which is a big improvement. So, and we look at the particular case, which is the easiest case, when P1 and P2 is equal to B, and P sigma P nu1 and P nu2 is equal to G. So this case in when, you see, this case, if P, let me see. You see when P nu is equal to G, there is no induction here. So what you have is just, there is no induction. So you have just a tensor product here. This is G, so it is an extension tensor by a generalized Sternberg representation. And you, okay, so in this case, you have that the Proprio Heck algebra is just a group algebra, where a group algebra of a group lambda with the quotient of the Lewy subgroup of B, Z, modulo is Proprio subgroup, is just an intersection with Iori. So, very easy, a group algebra. And our generic algebra is also a group algebra of a finite quotient lambda bar of lambda. Very nice. Very nice. It's much easier. So this, okay. And U1 and U2 will be simple module here. And what is a simple module for the Proprio of M? It's just an irreducible representation of Z, which is trivial here. This means a reducible representation of lambda. And it will extend to H of G. Then I will tell you what it means to extend to G. It means just mean that it's inflated from the quotient lambda bar. The representation of Z that are inflated, I mean of lambda that are inflated from lambda bar are exactly correspond to the simple representation that extends to H of G. And then the theorem, the particular case of the theorem, tells you that the extension I of the extended generalized Sternberg representation is isomorphic to extension I minus is delta of nu1 and nu2 in the category of C lambda bar module. And lambda bar is a finite group. So it is something that we should know. I mean, which is not part of the periodic theory, but part of the finite group theory. If you suppose a new one and new two is trivial, you get the generalized Sternberg representation. When new one, new two is trivial, new one, new two is trivial, it's just the cohomology of this group. Coefficient is a trivial representation in C, cohomology. So it is equal to this. When G is split and simply connected, we are quite happy because this question is trivial. So we know what is the answer. And so the cohomology of the trivial group is trivial, is equal to zero if this I is different from zero. And if I is equal to zero, is equal to C. So we know exactly what are those with G split and simply connected. Another example, well, it is still split, but not simply connected. It is when delta bar is equal to G is equal to PGL2F, which is the case of Braden-Pascunas, then delta bar is a two group of order two of order four. Order two if P is equal to two, order four if P different from two. And because the two groups, then the cohomology is equal to zero if I different from zero and P different from two. Because the characteristic of C is equal to P. So very nice. And if P is equal to two, then you prove, it's well known that because two groups that each I will be different from zero when I is even. And you see, like this, immediately that you can have infinitely many I such that the XI between the Sternberg representation is not zero. It is true for every choice of Q1 and Q2, in particular for the trivial representation. And this one was noticed by Kosciol in 2019. It comes all these corollaries for this beautiful extension theorem that I give here. Okay. So I'm looking at the time to see what I can say. Oh, yes, still have 10 minutes. So the proof of the extension theorem, I give you some words. So to show that P1 should be equal to P2 if it's not zero, you compute the central character of an induced module, of a parabolically induced module. This is the way you do it. If P1 is different from P2, then the central character are not the same, then the thing is zero. When P1 is equal to P2 equal to P, you have three steps. You reduce to generalized Sternberg module, like that. And you have some conditions, and you see what is happening. It is either zero or an extension between Sternberg representation, either zero, and you have the condition. And this method, this use adjoint functors that we have, like for the parabolic induction, but it use also duality related to some evolution of each of G. But that's a problem if you want to work with the group, because for the group, you don't have duality when the characteristic is P. But here, we use duality, which is very specific for the pro-P Warby Hack algebra. Then you have the reduction to extension from the Sternberg generalized, and this use also duality. These two steps use duality. And the third step is now you have between extension, you have to go back, it was not new one here. Then you want to go back to new one and new two, and then This is here that will appear the generic algebra. It want to go from extension. You want to compute x between extension of nu1 and nu2. So it's an x. We don't move the I. It is an x between nu1 and nu2. And this you don't use duality. But will appear this ideal, then you have to take the quotient of each of G by an ideal, and this quotient is a generic Hacker algebra. You see the shift of the index I appears when you go from the generalized, extended generalized Steinberg to extension. When the Steinberg disappear, then you have the shift for the I. But you keep the extension, but the Steinberg disappear while it gives a delta. So now we are interacting with xi between irreducible representation for the group. Or in general, x tie between this R representation that with whom we are working in mod R of G. So to simplify, I will go fast because there are a lot of results, but they are very partial all the time, but they are all explain what is happening for the Proprietary Hacker algebra. They are just the same. So this thing that we proved, which proved for Proprietary Hacker algebra, which is true for Proprietary Hacker algebra, this thing here should be true, in fact, for the group. Is it true or not? I don't know, but it should be true. I think it should be true. So it's known when R is a field of complex numbers. It's very classical, Castleman, 1981, with then one of them was a trivial representation, and then Schneider-Eschtuller 10 years later. But one of them was a classical Steinberg representation, and then the group was only PGLN. Then Orlik in 2005 proves this, but with restriction, R should be self-injective, and the pro-order of any open compact circle of G should be invertible in R. And that proved it independently when R is fortement banal. Recently, there is a paper of Comes, Dospinescu, Ose and Isiol, where they prove that it is true when with the condition P is bigger or equal to 5 and R is Artinian and P is nilpotent in R. And this is also proved, I don't know which condition in Ose, in Ose Schmidt-Sorensen in 19, I think they prove, they consider the case, I forgot. I think they consider, and also they consider only x1. Then they consider p1 equal to p2 is equal to p, and sigma prime smooth, that is also Schmidt-Sorensen 19. They do that. And they suppose that they extend to G, this is sigma 1, sigma 2. And then they prove exactly, look at that, only for x1. They could compute the x1 of two extensions. It is the same one, it should be sigma 2 here. And they prove the x1, but they have to define M by this. You know that sigma extends to G if and only if it is trivial on this group. And they prove that if you take off the extension, then it's the same thing that the x1 of the R of the representations M modulo this group of set 1 and 2. This is exactly what was happening here. Excuse me. This is exactly the same thing as that. You replace H of M by H M of I instead. This is really exactly the same thing. I find it extremely interesting. And other Schmidt and Sorensen prove that P is nilpotent in our Artinian. This is also X of ST Q of sigma. I mean, you can put the Sternberg, you can add the Sternberg. And this is quite interesting because so duality was not a problem. And other alone, as many result on XI of and on induced representation. So there is a lot of similarity. And I think there is a lot of work to do. Now I have, I don't know what time it is, I have three slides that maybe it's not necessary. I will not speak of them. I just show them. They exist. I can. So I'll say this quickly. One is about ordinary module, but let us forget about it. Another here, you can compute the I invariant of I representation over any R instead of the, you can compute explicitly instead of this module for the Propy Wahi Haeckel algebra. And the other thing, it was an other side of the adjoint parabolic induction. I was looking at admissibility. And also I say that we can compute the value of the adjoint on this representation. And you do this over NAR, but with some condition. Either you want sigma of P torsion or R noetherian and sigma admissible and also sigma of ordinary part zero. And then you can prove that the image of the adjoint functor are exactly of the same form. They are the same form. They are the same form or if they are not zero. And what is very funny is that if you look at the trivial representation, when P is nilpotent and R is noetherian, then the trivial representation, when you take the left invariant adjoint, it gives one, it's clear, but the right invariant, it gives zero. And for the Sternberg representation, if you look at the co-invariant by the unipotent radical, it is zero. But when you do with the right invariant, it is one. It is really funny. It is not at all when it is complex representation. And when C is a field of theoretic P and V is reducible admissible, we deduce that the image of V by the left and right invariant is zero R. Irreducible. So this is all what I wanted to say. And so now it's over. I don't know how to stop. You should tell me how to stop that. I hope, I don't know if you heard me in fact, because I don't know, it's not mute. Can you say something?
Yes, maybe I can hear you.
Yeah.
Without anybody listening to me.
Yes, thank you. So are there questions? I'm here.
I had a question, Marie-France. Hi, it's Udi. Hi, do you hear me?
Yeah, of course, I hear you. Yeah.
Okay, good. So in the classical setup, there is theorems of De Concini and Clausel about limit multiplicities of supercuspidals in L2 G mod gamma that asymptotically appear in multiplicities that are proportional to the volume.
Yeah.
Do you expect, so you mentioned this representation rho gamma, which is essentially the smooth part of functions on G mod gamma.
Yeah.
So do you expect that every supersingular representation, say F is characteristic zero, do you expect that every supersingular representation will eventually appear there and maybe with multiplicities that's proportional to the volume?
That's a very good question. In fact, it's a question where I really intend to think about. It's a very good question. In fact, I think that admissible representations are very important. And so it's a very good question. I don't know. But I think it's very possible.
But you do not have a counterexample.
I have no counterexample. We work quite hard in order to prove there is one.
Yeah, no, of course.
It's just the beginning. But so it is a very difficult, it's a very good question. I think this is a question that deserves to be studied. It's a totally excellent question.
Thanks.
This admissible representation had not been studied enough. But in fact, this is all what you do when you do global Langrands. This is what you do. What do you do when you do global Langrands? This is all what you do. I mean, you get when you suppose that you take groups that are compact at infinity modulo their center. So what do you do? How do you construct this gamma? How do you construct this gamma? What do you do? This is what people do without knowing that it is only this representation, G mod gamma when G is periodic.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, very good question.
Yeah. Other questions? I have just one remark. I remember that there's the paper of Coleman, Dospina's group, also Nizu, so they only treat some extension one, right?
Yes, yeah, S1, it is one, there's an X1, but now there's a new one with other where there is XI, I think, or maybe I'm wrong.
Oh, you mean there is a new paper treating the extension I for higher degree?
I have it on my laptop. I can look. I don't have it with me. I thought they had XI, but maybe not. Maybe they have only X1. Maybe I was. I didn't.
Yeah, take my yeah. Oh, you mean all those Schmidt and Sorensen? Okay.
There is. I think the one with all the Schmidt and Sorensen, they look only at X1, and I think with other with I think they have XI. Maybe not. But I think maybe they have X1. Let me see, maybe I am wrong. I am not sure. I don't have the paper with me. And I could, it is on my laptop, but I don't know how to move from the
Okay, it's fine. After the talk, it's fine.
Do you think they have only X1? Maybe they have only X1. Maybe they have only X1.
Maybe but one, yeah.
I am sorry. Excuse me. Yeah. Yeah, now I remember. So I was too fast when I wrote this. Mm. They prove, I will tell you what they prove. They have a theorem 1.8. What they prove that this is equal to zero, the X1, excuse me, is X1.
Yeah, X1.
It's equal to zero, is I bigger or equal to 2.
Yeah, I see.
No, this X1 is X1. I should have put S1 starting from here. Here I am missing S1. Starting from here is only X1. Where I am. Yeah, starting from here I am mixing X1. Probably at X1 the beginning and then I erased it. No, it's X1. Starting from here is X1. You are totally right. They look on the S1 and here also on X1 and X1 and all the I here, I think.
Okay.
X1. They find it much too difficult to have XI.
Yeah, sure.
But I come back from the proof here. which I think very interesting. Here, to prove P1 is equal to P2 equal to P, you use central character of what is happening central character when you do parabolic induction. But you have to know that the center of the proprietary Hecke algebra is much more than the center of the group. It's much more. But there is something to understand if you want to go to the group. Here, I don't know, because here I think you need also to have duality. And this is a problem that they find very hard and they cannot solve in the X1 law of Colmes, Dobzhinescu, Ose. The problem of the duality is a problem because you have to exchange things. You see, duality is used because this doesn't, it's very symmetrical. When you do, with duality means that you work symmetrically. The X1 of the trivial and the Steinberg is the same thing as the X1 of the Steinberg and the trivial. And you do this with duality. But for the group, it's different. Going to extension, you use duality, but what you do, you just take off the Steinberg. But Steinberg is so special, it works, behaves so beautifully that maybe duality here is not really essential. And this is what, in some sense, what they did with Schmidt, Ose and Schmidt. They managed to do this for X1. And they had no duality. And maybe it's possible to extend it. I don't know. And here, there's no duality at all. So maybe this can be done in general for the group. Because this this generic Hecke algebra HM mod I, they correspond exactly to this group here. They correspond exactly to this. This is exactly Propi Wari Hecke algebra corresponding to that. So this is why I gave this talk. As meaning, I prepared a talk that was different with the extension, but I thought I should, so that people have some interest, I should speak of this paper from Abbe that is not known because it's not published, in fact. So it's a reason to not. Yeah.
Okay, so let's thank Professor Vinyas again. And the next talk will be about in 10 minutes, given by Bangan and Shan.
Okay.
See you soon.